I'm the sparkle master. I make a sparkle.
Hello there! Welcome to our little alcohol-fueled joyride, folks. I'm Dr. Seeker, your friendly controller, and a heck of a bartender if I do say so myself. But let's not talk about me, let's talk about you. You're about to head into an audio journey through the adult side of Disney. Let's talk about booze. Pour it. Drink it. The adult humor can get a bit rough out there, so the alcohol will numb the senses. Flash photography? I wouldn't. It alters the tastefulness of the nudes you should be sending, and that's not good. Oh, and one more thing. I know it sounds sordid, but you'll be rewarded when at last I am given my dues. And injustice deliciously squared, be free. Hey, Three Sheets Nation, this is a special weekly episode of Three Sheets to the Mouse. It's just me and Scott tonight. We're hanging out. We have a little extra time, and we wanted to give you the opportunity to hear Scott's opinion on last week's episode. I know he missed it, but I know he also listened to it. And Scott's an opinionated guy. He's got the hair. He's got the face. Look at him. He's smelling his whiskey. He's a sweetheart. He's a smart guy. He's our Einstein. He's gonna drop the nukes on you tonight,
dude. That is a heavy intro. Look, I missed you all last week, and I just wanted to, you know, Trent and I were literally just hanging out. We decided, you know what, let's hit record and see what happens. So,
well, and that's the thing is that last week's show was a top three episode, and we all gave our top threes on a lot of issues or opinions or restaurants or rides, and I think a lot of people want to know your opinion as well. So it gets down to the point where I'm going to ask you some questions and you're going to answer them. I'm going to give you some top threes and you're going to throw them at us.
So last week you guys did a bunch of top lists.
Top threes?
As Mikey calls them, top lists.
It's like fucking Sports Disney.
Yeah.
Wait, no.
Disney Sports Center. Disney Sports Center kind of thing.
Disney Center. Yeah, whatever the fuck you want to call it. So we did some lists and we wanted your opinion. I feel like the listeners want to know what you think.
So, well, let's go back 2 weeks ago when you wanted to throw out a top three quick service at the end of a 2-hour episode. And I definitely wanted to save that because that was a fun thing. So that one, I definitely have some opinions on. There's a lot of people that have opinions on quick service because quite honestly, it's the kind of like the go-to food when you don't have an ADR, when you don't have time to sit down for, and honestly, almost every single ADR these days tends to be like a 2-hour meal. Dinner takes like an hour and a half, 2 hours.
But quick service, I feel like it's much more accessible.
It is.
For a lot of families.
It is. Absolutely.
And you have kids, and it's not, I don't want to say quality, but the problem is there's a lot of quick services that I know about that are much more high quality than a lot of table services that I've been to, and that is really sad in Disney standards. But also, if we can help people out and give them the higher quality quick services, I mean, right?
Yeah.
Let's hear your top three quick services in the world, Scott.
Well, before we start, we missed a crucial part of tonight's episode or tonight's special.
Right.
What are you drinking?
Ha ha.
Because, I mean, well, this all started from drinks, right?
It did. And I was channeling my inner Tim. So I was at the store earlier. I got some Calumet. I saw Calumet on the shelf. And I was like, oh, shit, what's next to it? It's the Calumet Single Rack Black.
Mm-hmm.
And it might be my favorite bourbon that I've ever had.
It's good, man.
And for the price, it was about $50, which is, I mean, $50 is, I mean, for certain people, it's a substantial amount of money.
Well, here's,
I mean,
here's,
I stay at the All-Stars, so don't judge me, but I spend money on bourbon.
Well, here's the thing. Think of it this way. You buy a bottle of wine that lasts you a couple hours, right?
Right.
Okay. Bottle of wine is like $10. If you were to buy, if you were to buy, you know, five of those bottles of wine, that's 10 hours of drinking. A bottle of whiskey should last you, you know, if you have a stock, a couple months of a couple months worth of drinking.
Well, I only buy one at a time, so this bottle of Calumet will probably last me 2.5 weeks.
Right, which is more than 10 hours of drinking.
Oh, absolutely. This is going to last me 2 shows. Three shows. Probably this show, our show on Sunday, and next Sunday's show.
That's probably 10 hours right there.
Absolutely. Well, fuck, yeah. I mean, if I wasn't such a long-winded asshole, it would probably be slower, but I like to hear the sound of my own voice, except when I have to give edit reviews. So, Scott, now that we're through what we're drinking, what are you drinking?
Well, I'm drinking, what did you call this, licking a charcoal asshole?
No, it was a charcoal grill going ass to mouth with me.
Yeah, so this is Ardbeg 10. It is, there is nothing more Isla than Ardbeg. It is one of the peatiest whiskeys you will find. It is, what they do, is, give you a little background real quick, something I couldn't do on the show. Isla whiskey on Isla is made by peating the malt. What they do is they soak it in water in order to germinate a little bit, and that releases the sugars, the flavors, and all that. And then you have to stop that malting of the barley. And in order to do that, you have to dry out the malt with smoke and fire. What they do is they use peat. Peat is essentially dirt in on this island. And they carve it out, and then they fire it in a kiln, and then that smoke smokes the malt. It dries out the malted barley, and then they use that to distill, and it gives it this really smoky iodine campfire flavor, and it is just glorious. Trent doesn't think so, though.
So remember that, cheaters. The next time that your significant other asks you to rim their ass, say, well, I'd rather drink whatever Scott was drinking on the last podcast.
But it's not nutty.
It's the same thing.
But it's not nutty. It's smoky.
It doesn't taste like a copper penny?
No. It's smoky. It's like a campfire.
It tastes like 409 and a wood pellet grill were coming in your mouth.
I guess, man.
You're in a porno, and a wood-fire grill is just going to give you a huge facial.
I love
So, Scott, now that we're through what we're drinking, and you're pouring more of that god-awful, fucking chemically-tasting... It looks like white wine, but it tastes like you're chewing on Bigfoot's dick that's been burnt for 10 to 12 hours on a real... On a real crisp fire.
It looks like white wine because it's one non-chill filtered and there's no color added. A lot of whiskeys add E150 caramel coloring to give it a darker color because people associate with darker whiskey better quality.
And we don't like artificial colors, right, Scott?
I don't mind that because the Dalmore series, they use E150 and it doesn't affect the flavor whatsoever. So,
but we don't like artificial colors. I feel like that's... It's just not organic, right?
But you know what? The taste...
I'm just kidding. I don't give a fuck.
The taste is still there. People that shit on Dalmore... and you go back to our special with Daniel Whittington, the whiskey sommelier from the Whiskey Vault. People that shit on Dalmore are just bullshit.
Well, it's the same people that don't like artificial colors or gluten.
So anyways.
Yeah, anyway. So, Scott, my first question... of last week's episode was your top three quick services in Walt Disney World. So if you say Cosmic Rays, I'm going to hang up the Skype call immediately.
God, no, man.
You don't like that frog alien son of a bitch singing to you and playing the piano?
I'm glad that no one chose that. I was definitely surprised.
I was going to have to quit the show.
I wasn't really surprised with any of the choices there. For my top three, I think my, so you wanted people to go 3-1, and that's perfectly acceptable because that's the way it should go. So my number three would have to be Sunshine Seasons. I really like that. It's a good breakfast place, good lunch place.
It's great, everyone gets what they want.
Yeah. It's nothing bad there. Nothing is horrible there. The weird thing is, it smells like pepperoni pizza and they don't even serve it. You walk in the land and it smells like pepperoni.
Yes, it's. I mean, there's a lot of meat and fat getting seared. Yeah, no, I agree. You go to 3-1. We went to the other format. You get a little muddy. So, yeah. Yeah, I mean, we're just you though. So let's go.
So
what's
my
number two.
My number two. God, this is tough because I want to say Yak and Yeti Quick Service, and I know you hate that.
I only hate it because I had the one experience, and it was not wonderful. And everyone else I talked to says it's great. I don't know if I had a bad. I need to try it again.
Maybe you just had a bad day.
It tasted like the Tyson chicken nuggets out of a bag that you literally opened the bag and put in the fucking microwave, and they threw some fucking veggies on there. And it was the problem was it was fucking $13 or $14.
But those are so good when you're hungover.
But I wasn't. That's the problem.
Maybe that's the problem.
I didn't have a motivation. I didn't have that I'm hungover, so let me eat these. It was, hey, we just went on Everest, and I need a lunch before we head over to Pandora, and this is fucking garbage. And yeah. Stephanie's wasn't bad, but mine was very Buffalo Wild Wings, Boneless Wings-esque.
See, and I'm okay with that, because I love B-dubs.
Well, the one here makes me want to burn the building to the ground.
So I did not go angry, with that, because my number two, and this wasn't mentioned at all, is Tangerine Cafe.
Where's that at?
In Morocco, in Epcot.
Ah, never. I've only passed by. I've never had that. So tell us a little bit about it.
Let me tell you a little bit about Tangerine Cafe. It is a good quick service place. I have a son who has a diet of chicken nuggets, pasta, white cheese pizza, and grilled cheese sandwiches, and that's
So he's Jewish Italian. Okay, cool.
Yeah. So Wendy's. Any chicken nuggets, really. But Wendy's are his favorite. The Tangerine Cafe has a kid's meal with chicken nuggets that are spiced in Moroccan spices, and they kind of taste like Wendy's chicken nuggets.
Well, Wendy's got rid of the spicy chicken nuggets, and I wanted to also burn that building to the ground.
No, these aren't spicy. They're like the spiced chicken nuggets that Wendy has.
No,
in
I get what
places.
You're talking about. I was just mentioning Wendy's. So, if Wendy's is listening, get on your fucking shit.
But they're amazing, and he ate the shit out of them. So that was one to go to for me. But also,
we love Morocco though, like as a whole.
I mean, I love the pavilion.
Morocco's the most underrated country in the World Showcase.
Oh, absolutely.
If they have a great ride, bar, those fucking mixed drinks at that bar that's right on the water are so underrated.
Spice Road table.
People completely pass by Morocco because they go, "Oh, Morocco, who gives a shit." That's not a name that I understand or recognize.
Yeah.
But if you stop in Morocco, it's not busy, and the drinks are strong, and they're great.
So the only dish I've ever gotten in Morocco is the shawarma lamb platter. It's essentially, if you've ever had a gyro or gyro.
That's one of my favorite foods of all time.
Yeah. It's essentially a gyro. They've got hummus, tabbouleh, couscous salad, and then Moroccan bread, which is kind of like pita bread. It's kind of non-ish. Yeah, it is a wonderful platter. I love it. I love that is the only thing I've had there, and I will get that almost every time. I would like to try the chicken and lamb shawarma, which is a combination of the two, because it looks good, it smells good in there, and casa beer is awesome. You can't go wrong with a casa beer. So then my number one, and I don't think there's a better place for quick service than Magic Kingdom. I think Magic Kingdom is suited best for quick service. So My number one for Magic Kingdom is Columbia Harbor House. It is one place we always go if we need a bite in the Magic Kingdom. The runner-up for that would be Sleepy Hollow refreshments. You guys talked about it. The chicken and waffle sandwich from a few years ago, they brought it back, is killer. You know, nobody ever talked about it on the show because you guys never had it, but my God, it is one of the best things I've ever eaten in my life. I kid you not.
I mean, I love chicken and waffles. Being from the South, I mean, we have plenty of restaurants here that brunch, the big seller is fried chicken, waffles, maple syrup, and mustard. A good spicy mustard. And I've never had it. That's the huge issue, is everyone talks about it. I've never fucking been there.
You know, it's weird because they used to have the sandwiches only available during certain times of the day, but now they have them, I think, almost all day long. The sweet and spicy chicken waffle sandwich, it's $8.99. It is wonderful. They've added hand-dipped corn dogs, pretzel dogs, funnel cake with powdered sugar. It's great. Definitely go there.
Well, Magic Kingdom needed that, though.
Totally.
I mean, name the other good quick service besides Pecos Bill's and Columbia Harbor House in Magic Kingdom.
I haven't been to Pecos Bill's since they updated the menu, and I'm going to say, I know you guys shat on it a little bit, but I do love Casey's Corner. But, baseball.
I love hot dogs when I grill them at home. The problem is I'm not paying $10 for a hot dog just because I'm somewhere that I love. And the problem is, too, is that Pecos Bill's also removed the guacamole from their Fixin's bar, which I was listening to a podcast earlier it was a recent podcast. I don't know if they didn't know or not that the guacamole got taken off of the Fixin's bar at Pecos Bill's. So the thing is that Disney is cutting a lot of corners.
Yeah.
Not to mention Casey's Corner. So the problem that I have with that, leading back to Casey's Corner, is that at what point do they lower the quality of the hot dogs at Casey's Corner? Because right now they're decent. You get that decent snap from the casing, and that's what everyone looks for a hot dog. So if you like hot dogs, there's people that love hot dogs, and there's people that think that they're gross. And the people that love hot dogs want that hot dog that has that snap casing. They want that sweet pork flavor. They want that crispy, caramelized outside on that casing. But how long before Casey's Corner becomes a cheap chicken product buy meal fucking hot dog?
So we're probably going to start a fight here, but how do you, like, obviously Casey's has the, different specialty hot dogs during the year. Like the last time I was there, they had like a Korean barbecue dog with like kimchi and stuff, and I was like, nah, I'm okay with that. I wanted the chili cheese dog with like pulled pork on it. That's what I wanted. Let's start a fight.
Yeah.
How do you take a hot dog?
Like where I'm from?
No. What do you put on it?
My preferred, if I had my ultimate. So you're not gonna like this. I put mayonnaise in the bun before I put the hot dog on.
I'm okay with that.
Put the hot dog on. Ketchup.
Yep.
Hot sauce.
I could pass on that.
Crumbled potato chips.
That'd be good.
And feta cheese.
That's weird. The last one you got me. You got me with the last
That's
one.
That's my ultimate hot dog.
I'm down with the mayonnaise. Because I'm from California and mayonnaise goes on everything. But for me, like when we go to, so we have a place here in New Jersey called Rutt's Hut. It's famous for deep fried hot dogs. They deep fry them. They're delicious. And I get looks every time I put ketchup on a hot dog because in the Northeast, it's mustard and mustard only. And that's it. That's all they put on it. So for me, a hot dog is, and I go back again, baseball, Dodger dogs. Ketchup, mustard, relish, and raw onions.
See, I'm not a relish guy. I'll do raw onions, but if I'm doing raw onions, it's going to be yellow mustard, sauerkraut, and raw onions.
Sauerkraut and hot dogs.
So I go very regional. So the thing is, I like everything. I'm a fat piece of shit. So the problem is that I can't mix the regions.
I don't disagree with you. There's nothing.
I'm doing Chicago dog. I'm doing a Northeast, or I'm doing my Southeast fucking ketchup potato chip shit. So like, yeah, I'll do your Northeast shit. I'll do sauerkraut and mustard and onions, or I'll do just mustard. But I'm not mixing this shit. So, but whatever mood I'm in, and then the people behind me want to give me looks, I'm like, fuck you, I like everything. Yeah. Don't judge me while I'm doing the one thing that I'm doing right now.
See, that's why you gotta go to Pink's. They have like 25 different hot dogs.
Pink's sounds like a strip club.
Now, Pink's in Los Angeles is a hot dog joint. It is
If
outrageous.
Pink's is in Los Angeles, it sounds even more like a strip club.
It does sound like a strip club, but it's not. It is a hot dog stand. It is amazing. It's glorious.
Go to Pink's. We have the best wieners in the city.
Like, right? That's what it sounds like.
Yeah. So what was your next top three, guys?
All right. The next top three.
Or one of them. We'll just go through a couple of them.
So, Scott, my next favorite top three that we did was top three songs from the Disney universe that are sung by characters in Disney movies. Now, and we kind of convoluted it with Pixar characters or anything in the Disney universe that's sung by a character. What are your top three with those?
Oh, so this one, I definitely got a crossover with Adam because my number three is definitely Hercules Go the Distance. It's sung by Hercules in the movie.
I just haven't seen this enough.
Oh, it's such a good movie. It really is. It gets lost because this is about the time that Disney was doing a lot of direct-to-DVD shit. And so Hercules kind of got lost in the shuffle between the what I call the renaissance of Disney animation, which is Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Lion King. And then into the Pixar area of, like, Toy Story and all of those. So it was, like, right in between all of that. I actually think Pixar or Toy Story and Hercules came out probably within a year of each other. But Hercules Go the Distance is my number three. Wonderful song. The track that they use in Wishes was always one of my favorite parts. Absolutely love that one. Number two, man, it's so hard to pick just three top songs. Number two is probably would probably have to be, I think this is getting harder to pick a number two than a number three because there's so many I want to pick here. My number two would be Gaston. I absolutely love that song.
Really? No, I mean, it's a good song, and I do love it. And I do love Gaston, but that's not what I expect you to say.
It's a fun song to sing with, like, group of people around you. It's basically a drinking song. So I think I would choose that one because it's kind of like you're in a bar with your friends and you're drinking and you're just telling stories through song. And so, yeah, I'll go with Gaston as my number two.
Gaston is one of my favorite characters. I'm very much not identified because he doesn't have a huge beard and no hair, but Gaston is very manly, and I know in the end he comes out a loser, but I also feel like a loser a lot of the time. So, we'll identify at this point. That's a good choice. So, what is your number one Disney song that's sung by a character in the movies?
Oh, this is no question. I mean, and everybody who's listening should know what I'm about to say here. And that's Feed the Birds. It is my favorite Disney song of all time. There's absolutely no question about it. Feed the Birds, bestest song ever. Ever. Also is Walt's favorite.
So Scott, for everyone that doesn't know where that song is from, can we get an explanation?
Well, I mean, if you've been living under a rock since 1963.
Sure, yeah, a lot of us are born after that, so.
Well, so I was too, but Feed the Birds is sung by Julie Andrews, who is probably one of Disney's best singers of all time, and the the tragedy that happened to her voice is absolutely horrific, and we've lost a treasure because of it. But she sings Feed the Birds. It was written by the Sherman Brothers for the movie Mary Poppins. It is a wonderful song about stopping and just taking a second to look around you and appreciate the little things in life.
It's a bag, tuppence, 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 a bag.
And that's kind of what the movie's about. So if you've ever seen Mary Poppins, it is the story of recapturing your youth, recapturing family, and learning to put the grind of work aside to spend time with your family and be part of life, and instead of just going through the motions. And that's what this song is really about. So there's no question, and I'm shocked that none of you guys mentioned it on the show.
I think the problem is that we all appreciate the classics, but at the same time, the thing that first pops into our head is the more modern movies, and you can't blame us for that. You're the only old soul, I think, on the show.
Yeah, probably. I mean, look, I'm a nostalgic person. I've been told this a time and time again. Every time my boss walks into my office listening to Miles Davis, I'm an old soul. I like the old stuff.
So, but I do think, but a lot of people didn't know who Powerline was, and that also made me real sad.
I'm shocked that Tim and Adam didn't know who Powerline was right off the bat, because that is one, like, and maybe it's because I grew up as a kid in the 90s and watched Goof Troop and watched the Goofy movie. And
Goofy movie was...
So Powerline, I knew who that was. I mean, like, I don't know the song off the top of my head because I haven't watched the movie in a long time, but I knew
every
word
for word anytime you wanted, brother.
You're such a millennial.
I have it on my phone. I can play it right now. Okay, anyway.
Drop it right now.
Let's go to our next topic and keep this show going so it's not a regular length episode.
It'll be a special length.
Yeah, you know, but it might turn into that. So don't stop listening, guys. So, Scott, your top three underrated attractions in Disney World.
Oh, that's easy. Number three is Tiki Room. I think people just pass by it.
I've never done it.
Number two, I will say, is Dinosaur. I do think that it doesn't get the love that people give to it now that Pandora and Everest is open.
It's never gotten the love. Dinosaur's never gotten the love.
I love Dinosaur. Great ride. I wish it didn't break down as much, and I wish it wasn't as dark. It's very dark in there.
They've made it darker recently, which is...
Because animatronics stopped working.
I get that. But the problem is that it breaks so much. It's a very difficult ride system. The ride system that they have designed for it is very, very...
temperamental. It's temperamental. Well, it's the same thing.
They have to have a lot of people to work on it all the time, and they don't have the people because everyone... Disney's been cutting back. Let's be honest. Disney is cutting back in every aspect, and we can only assume that they're cutting back in their mechanical engineers that are working on these rides. So the problem is that Disney is so... Or Dinosaur is so mechanic necessary heavy that it's not getting the attention that it needs.
Well, and look, you know, not to plug another show that I do listen to, but Jim Hill and Len Testa were talking about this on the Disney Dish. Bob Chapek
is a robot.
He is a robot, but the reason he is where he is because he's cut costs at Disney World so much for maintenance issues that he's made the company money, and that's why he's kind of favored with Bob Iger. But he has directed people to, or mechanics, to be less intensive, to repair things less, to make do with what you got and kind of find a way around it. And while that's fine, it's a good idea because you should strive people to do their best work at the cheapest, at the least expensive means possible, but you do have to put the money in to make sure these rides are operating at 100% capacity.
So, Scott, I completely agree with what you're trying to say, but as as an HVAC tech, what I do in my personal life, when you go and check a unit, and we do what's called PMs, which are preliminary checks, we check units on the units we're checking, and we make sure nothing's wrong. You have to do preventative maintenance, or I think PM might actually stand for preventive maintenance. I don't know. I'm a little drunk. So you check for you check what's wrong. Are these motors okay? Are the fan motors okay? Are there any leaks in the compressors? So the problem is that they're not paying the techs to do what they need to do. They're cutting hours on those techs, on those engineers
that need to be checking that
shit. And the problem is that shit breaks and it's making customers unhappy.
Well, it also doesn't allow the rides to be operated on 100% capacity or 100% operation,
which makes people think that the parks are busier than they are, and they're not.
Exactly.
The parks are not as busy as people think they are in the off season. Disney is making it seem that way because the rides are not operating at capacity.
You cut back ride operation, you save money. I know. Look, I've met Bob Chapek. He's a nice guy.
Well, you should have kicked him in his dick because he's an asshole. No, he's not a nice guy.
He's a nice person.
He's a money-making robot. No, he's not. He's not a nice guy.
He's a nice person, but I don't believe in his directive.
I think that he's doing a lot of bad things for Disney, Scott.
So then my number one...
He could be a nice guy. I could be a nice guy, too, but I could still be a fucking huge asshole.
So then my number one underrated attraction, I think is Carousel of Progress.
Oh God! You just said that.
I did.
You said it out loud.
The fact that a lot of people just pass by it and don't do it, it's a shame because it's one of the last Walt Disney attractions. So,
do you think it has anything to do with the last scene being 30 years out of date?
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. It's a look back in the past.
I think it does matter.
It's a look back in the past.
Right, it could be a look back in the past if they made it to the original. Change that last scene to the original that was in the World's Fair.
I would like that. I think that'd be fun. But at the meantime, I would be sad. I'd be sad to see this go. It's a ride that I love, and I listen to the soundtrack on my iPhone whenever I go to sleep at night. I do listen to Disney Parks stuff on my iPhone or on my headphones, and this would be sorely missed if it goes away.
So, do you think it needs a refurb?
No, because you can't refurb it because that's not Walt's. Unfortunately, you know, Brian talked about it on our Marvel episode, the parks becoming a museum. Unfortunately, this is a museum piece. This is one of the things that you can't really change too much. I think you could probably change the last episode, but keep the original three to start, and then just finish up with a new final scene. I'd be okay with that.
So, I want to throw some shit at you for the most underappreciated rides. Living with the Land.
Oh, totally underappreciated. That's a top five, absolutely. I love that ride. That is a ride that we do at least 2 to 3 times a trip.
Yeah, I mean it's amazing. We're doing the behind the scenes in April with Brant and Sydney, and it's one of those things that when people say, "Oh, you know, I have friends that go to Disney," and they're like, "What was that weird boat ride underneath the restaurant besides Soarin'?" I'm like,
"Yeah, it's a good one.
I will fucking burn your house down." Like, what are you talking about?
It's a good one.
That's one of the best rides in Disney. And it's very unappreciated, in my opinion. And I don't know if I mentioned it on the last episode, but...
I don't think it's under... It's not under-attended. It's underappreciated because people sit there and they ride through it because it's something to do while they wait for their Soarin' Fast Pass.
And that's what I'm throwing at you. I'm just throwing some...
Yeah.
And I should have done this with the earlier categories. People Mover.
It's a good sit down, get off your feet, time killer. You never have to wait in line for it. I don't know how you can't find it, Mikey. I really don't. I love it. Love People Mover.
So I'm going to throw some new categories. I can't remember all the old ones. But we're going to say three attractions in Disney that you would get rid of right now with no repercussions. You wouldn't feel bad. From three to one, three attractions, be it shows, rides, anything that you would get rid of and have no remorse.
All right. Finding Nemo the Musical. In 18 years of going to Disney World, or actually 10 years of it being in existence, never found time to do it. Don't. I'm sorry. Bye, Felicia.
So with that, before you go to the next one, what if they made it into a Finding Dory? What if it evolved to a Finding Dory show?
Still wouldn't interest me.
You don't like the puppets? You don't like the show?
It's a weird show, man. I'm sorry.
I like it. I mean, I agree. I understand your opinion. I'm just saying I do think it needs to evolve. At this point, I think it needs to be a Finding Dory. It needs to be something. But I understand your opinion. So go back to
episode, I think, 4, Liars, Snakes, and Hobo Naps. Never been on it. Not missing much.
Okay. Let's go to your number 2.
Number 2. Let's see. Other rides I wouldn't miss. I was trying to think of anything in Hollywood Studios, but there's only like 4 rides right now.
No, there's nothing in Hollywood Studios that can go away. Come on, man. I feel like these are obvious. This is even a question that I had, and I feel like I could crush you in it.
Epcot. Epcot's everything's necessary in Epcot. I like everything in Epcot.
Nope, that's not true.
What?
The France movie, no one gives a shit.
Oh yeah. You could probably get
China movie, no one cares.
No, I like the China movie. I do like that one. You could probably get rid of the two movies in France and Canada and replace them with an actual ride. There's enough land, and obviously now we know that Ratatouille's in France.
Yeah.
Honestly, the France movie will be a holding pattern for those with a fast pass for Ratatouille.
All right, so you can't think of anything in Epcot besides that?
Yeah, just those two attractions. I like everything else. I like Test Track. I love Mission Space. Well, I love the old Mission Space.
Jeremy Irons style.
Spaceship Earth is a must.
Oh, Spaceship Earth, yeah, no.
Yeah, that's a
Mission
must.
Mission Space is fucking horrible. I just want to die.
Love that time. Ride.
So, Magic your number King. One most hated, not most hated, I guess, most unmemorable, get rid of it, no one would give a fuck attraction in Walt Disney World, Scott.
Is Stitch still open?
No, that doesn't count. You cheating motherfucker.
You could probably get rid of... I hate to say this because I do like the movie. You could probably get rid of the Swiss Family Robinson Treehouse.
That is a cop-out. Everyone knows that shit. That stares the attraction. Pick another one.
I like
one.
It.
That's
I like
garbage.
It, but you could get rid of it.
Pick another one. That's trash. You copped out.
Well, I mean, I don't think you can get rid of anything else in Magic Kingdom. I like everything else.
No one said Magic Kingdom. I said Walt Disney World.
I don't know if there's any other underrated.
The answer is obvious.
What's that?
It's the Tomorrowland Speedway.
Oh yeah, you know what? You're right. I forgot about that one because, I would like to see that updated. And if I said this on an episode way back in the day, when.
I fucking hate the entire attraction.
When Disneyland first opened, if you go back and watch the opening day video of Disneyland, Frank Sinatra and Sammy Davis Jr. are driving cars on Autopia in Disneyland. There is no track. If you got rid of that track and made that an actual like roadway where people could drive on it, it would be fun.
You think that could happen in today's climate?
Because
that could hit my kid. I want to sue the whole planet. It's never gonna happen, dude.
I know. I don't know. You're right. That could go away. That could definitely go away.
That's obviously everyone's number one.
Mm-hmm.
To give my opinion, this is not a question we got asked. So getting rid of things, it is a tough question. Tomorrowland Speedway is obviously my number one. Number two would have to be...
Wait. Enchanted... Or the flying carpets. Get rid of those.
Oh, you mean the reed-themed Dumbo?
Yeah, get rid of those.
With the spitting shitty camel?
Yep,
that,
get rid of
I'm
it.
Not even going to mention that because it's not
all necessary. That, all that does... And,
any
and
spinning ride. Triceratops spin... what's the dino coaster?
Well,
the
no,
barnstormer?
No, no.
That shit's all implied.
No, no, I don't have a problem with Hector. What is it? Chester and Hester's dino spin, because that doesn't take away from anything.
Triceratops spin.
Triceratops spin.
It's that fucking horrible. It's the same fucking ride.
But it doesn't. It doesn't cause any problems.
It's a corny ride. The whole Dino Land can get fucking
right,
blown up.
But Aladdin's Magic Carpets don't offer anything good to the ride, and all it does is create a logjam of people walking through Adventureland.
Adventureland. No, I get it.
That's my problem.
So that ride can obviously go away, but Dino Land, my number two is gonna be Dino Land as a whole.
Yeah, other than Dinosaur. I like Dinosaur.
No, and I don't consider Dinosaur in Dinoland. That Carney area, that's my whole number two.
Yeah,
on this question.
I'd say that needs a retheme. After the 50th, that's probably on the chopping block.
And my number three is going to be real controversial. It's weird for me to say, but I think a lot of people like Tom Sawyer's Island. But do something with that. Goes there.
I would miss it if it's gone because it's...
And that's what I'm saying.
It's a memory I have of a kid. Again, goes back to Disneyland. Of a kid walking around the island and going through the tunnels and acting like Tom Sawyer. But if it went away, if they filled up the Rivers of America for an actual land, I'd be okay with that.
That's what I'm saying, though.
It's a lot of space, man.
I don't want to piss people off, but Tom Sawyer's Island is such a unique area in the park that so much could be done with.
It is. It's a lot of space. That space is more than what they will use for more than what they would use for the Tron roller coaster and Seven Dwarfs Mine Train combined. It could definitely be utilized better. It's time to move on from Tom Sawyer's Island. So we got time for one more before we cut the show off.
All right, Scott. So the last one that we have is the top three characters that you would want to meet that aren't currently in the parks.
All right. So
in Walt Disney World. Let me add.
Right.
Yes.
So, number three, this character is in the parks on very, very, very rare occasion, like once a year. So I don't consider it a regular character, and that's
fair,
Robin.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
And that's Robin Hood, the
Ooh,
fox.
Yeah, good one.
Robin Hood is one of my favorite movies of all time.
It's fucking amazing.
It really is. It's a great movie. I love every iteration of the Robin Hood series, you know, because of my time in the London.
You like Men in Tights, don't you?
I do love Men. Dude, that is one of my favorite movies of all time.
I just wanted you to say yeah so I can get that clip of you saying, yeah, I like Men in Tights.
I do love Men in Tights.
Let's save that.
Did you say Abe Lincoln or Hey Blinken?
The Incredible Mr. Lincoln. Or no.
Number three would be Robin Hood. Number two... number three is easy to come up with. Number two is hard.
You're trying to plan them out too hard, dude.
I am. Number two would probably have to be the DuckTales crew. You guys mentioned that on the show.
You gotta pick one.
Then it's Launchpad, man. Launchpad McQuack is amazing.
Yeah.
I love the DuckTales series. I love the new series.
Launchpad McQuack.
Oh, Mr. McD, I'm so sorry. It's kind of like a Canadian accent he's got going on.
It's like if an Australian and a Canadian fucking had a love child.
Launchpad McQuack. I definitely want to meet him. Number one. Man. No. You know what? No brainer. Number one. Tony Stark.
That's impossible.
It's impossible.
Unless you have Robert Downey Jr. come to the parks, everyone's going to be fucking pissed.
How awesome would it be to have a meet and greet at one of the bars with Tony Stark? Because he's our Marvel hero.
Drinks. It would be fantastic, absolutely.
He drinks. He fucks his secretary.
He's married to her now, you asshole.
He's married to her now. He fucks his wife. But he drinks. He's the ultimate he's the ultimate cheater of all the Marvel superheroes. He's the ultimate cheater. And Captain America has missionary position. Iron Man is doggy style.
There we go. So you have it. This is Scott's top threes. And before he goes, I want to give him one more off the cuff that he wasn't aware of. Top three Mickey costumes in Walt Disney World. So we have Safari Mickey, we have Sorcerer Mickey, we have Tuxedo Mickey. What are your top three Mickeys?
All right, so number three is if you go to the Hollywood and Vine restaurant, it's kind of like 1920s Hollywood director Mickey. He's got like a beret on and is like plaid clothes. I like that one. So that's my number three.
Good one.
Number two is Sorcerer Mickey. I just think that's one you can't go wrong with.
Oh yeah.
Number one, a classic. Just the red pants with the yellow buttons.
There you go. I wish that one was in the park, and that's what bothers me so much with it. I want those red fucking pants, and I want those big fucking golden shoes. Give me that.
Very rarely do you see it in the parks.
It's nowhere. And it's really depressing.
The only time you'll see it is at the... If you're in Epcot during, like, January, February, or September and early October, when they're doing the college program training phases, and the character palooza right outside of the America Pavilion, you may find classic Mickey right there. Very rarely, though.
Mickey doesn't really exist. I've never seen it, and I think that's my number one Mickey too. But that was a little off the cuff for Scott for the top three Mickeys in the park.
That one was easy.
I don't know. I feel like a lot of people love the Mickey you see in the parks with his tuxedo. A lot of people love Talking Mickey with his magician.
I've never been to Talking Mickey.
I like Safari Mickey.
Yeah, why not? I mean, Safari Mickey's fun.
He's just got so many. He's got so many hats.
Yeah. Mickey wears a lot of hats. He's like Barbie. He does everything.
So for this semi long short episode, Scott.
It's an hour.
You want to give us a sign off?
Yeah. You know, I missed you guys last week. I love doing the show, and just scheduling wise, it just didn't work out. So. You know, glad to talk to you guys for a little bit. So, thanks.
So there it is. So the scheduling conflict was my fault. It's the reason that Scott wasn't on the show last week. I do apologize, but I'm glad we got to get to talk to Scott. I'm glad you guys got to hear from Scott this week. I know you guys all miss his sultry, big-haired, bird-chested voice. So I'm glad that everyone's here and everyone's getting to hear it. So until next week, we're going to be recording on Sunday. You guys are going to hear our fucking show every other week. This is just a special episode with me and the hair. So until next time,
wait, there you go. Can you do my? So
I can't. I don't. I can't. I can't do it. Do it for us.
So from all of us here at Three Sheets of Mouse, which is just me and Trenton right now, but from all of us here at Three Sheets of Mouse, thank you for making our show part of your Disney life. Thank you for your time, this time, and until next time, so long for just a while.
You're welcome. And thank you.
I've been drinking all night. I've been here for fucking 5 hours.